OJ Da Juiceman. OJ, what up? Welcome to VladTV.
How you doing, Sean? What it do, man?
I'm good. Good to see you, my brother.
I see them goals.
Them fronts is looking nice and shiny, brother.
Yeah, appreciate you guys having me, bro. For real. Thank you, man. Big honor, man. Salute.
Absolutely. Salute to you, my brother. Yo, so OJ Da Juiceman, like, yes. You are 100% Atlanta's own. Like,
yes.
Straight up. It's a lot of people who transplanted to Atlanta. Atlanta's the hotbed of hip-hop for so many years. But you born and raised in the A.
Yes, sir. Correct.
So what was it like growing up in the A in the 90s?
Whoo, man. My early years of Baltimore Sun Valley around that time, I want to say we probably was, like, playing in the creek. They had, like, a little lagoon in the part of the creek that probably went, like, super deep. And we put grocery shopping buggies down there so we could jump out for them like a diving board. That, from playing in the creek, probably taking out trash to picking up cans around in the 90s years.
Mm. You know, in the 90s, crack era was a little crazy.
True.
Definitely the 80s, but the 90s, it was still going on. What was crack like in your neighborhood back in them days?
It was heavily around. It was heavily around. Yeah, I can say that for sure.
Yeah, because most of your raps is always about the trap.
Yeah, I mean, I be just... people don't came to me like, Juice, why you don't rap about other stuff? But I look at it as I'll be lying. You know what I'm saying? Like, if I just sit here and tell you I make all girl music, I'll be lying, because that ain't what I do. I can sit here and say, hey, I worked at a mechanic shop. I'll be lying. You know what I'm saying? So what I seen is what I rap about.
You know, in a lot of ways, like I said, your music is about the trap. How involved in the streets was you?
Oh, man. It's hard to say, man. I know I worked at McDonald's. I worked at McDonald's for a full year before fully, like, going streetwise. I worked at McDonald's for, 12 months, 13 months. Got fired for getting caught stealing out the cash register.
Okay, so you was making most of your money in the streets?
Yeah, I come from the streets, correct.
Got you. Any arrests?
Oh, man. I mean, yeah, it's a few. I'm probably, as far as streetwise, I probably done been convicted three times. Three or four times, something like that.
Okay. So you was doing your thing out there in the streets in the early 90s, 2000s.
Yeah, you know, just being an old little kid trying to find their way, man.
You know, you almost can't tell your story without talking about Gucci.
True.
You know, true. Y'all, when you think of OJ Da Juiceman, you think about my boy Gucci.
Yeah, absolutely. For sure.
How did you meet Gucci?
Before we moved to Sun Valley, we were staying down on Custer Avenue, right off Boulder Crest, in Mountain Park. Gucci stayed, like, at the top part of Mountain Park. It was the thing about Mount Park, a lot of people call it gray brick, red brick, because Mount Park had two sides. You can be from the gray brick side or you can be from the red brick side. Me and Gucci was from the gray brick side. He stayed up top, I stayed down bottom. We moved from Mountain Park to Sun Valley, which is on Boulder Crest. I want to say Gucci done probably previously moved from Mountain Park before me and my mama them did. And when we got to Sun Valley, we was at the bottom again, and Gucci was at the top of Sun Valley. Because, see, Sun Valley was so big, it's four entrances to get in Sun Valley. So, depending on which way you come in, I was a bottom boy, and Gucci was a top boy.
How old was you when you met him?
Gray Brick, Mountain Park time. I moved to Sun Valley in second grade, so I probably knew Gucci probably like first grade on through. I probably met him when I was in first grade. I want to say Gucci is 2 years older than me, or two grade levels older than me. It might have been one. But I want to say, if I'm finna be 40 this year, I want to say Gucci 42, or either might be 41, finna be 42.
Okay, so you damn near knew Gucci your entire life.
True, correct. Him and his big brother, man, Big Duke.
What type of guy was he when he was young? What's some of the craziest things you seen him do before he blow up?
Man, I would say, bro, we don't did a lot of stuff. I remember one crazy night, he had a two-door box Chevy Landau, and he come pick me up early that day. We riding the whole day, whatnot. I end up falling asleep because we done been doing so much smoking weed, riding. I fall asleep. I just remember him waking me up like, hey, Ju, we here. So I look, and we at the club on Memorial Drive. So I'm like, oh, shit, we at the club. So I wake up. We went through the parking seat. That's what we used to do back in the day when you have a dope boy ride. You fix it up. You buy it from nothing, and you fix it up, rim it, put beat, and then you just ride around the city. And what we used to do was we put beat in the car. When you put beat in the car, it make you bounce. And when you get to a red light, you might whip to the right, whip to the left, but you done fucked up the lane to where everybody, like, if it's two lanes, you got your car whipped, and so you in both lanes. So I remember waking up, he tapping me, waking me up, like, Jude, we here. I see that we at the club, shit. My first instinct was to pull up, and we be bouncing, and, you know, just whip through the parking lot, because that's what we did. We weren't trying to go in the club. We just wanted to show, you know, that his car is fine, and we pulling up, and this how we doing, you know what I'm saying?
Was both of y'all into rap your whole life? When did you get into rap, and when did he get into rap?
Gucci probably been rapping, like, doing talent shows and all that early. We come from an apartment. They got, like, a green generator. I guess it's the power supply for whatnot for the apartment or that area. We used to beat on a machine and just, you know, be freestyling, rapping, whoop the whoop. So we come from that. But I end up getting some time. And I had to go to, instead of going to prison, my lawyer worked it out the way I had to do boot camp time. And coming home from boot camp, this was like 05, 06, Gucci dropped Trap House. And when my sister done come to pick me up from down the road at the boot camp, they pulled up with Gucci CD, the Trap House album. I'm like, ooh. But before that, he already had an album, which was with my buddy Woe.
What's that, the Straight Drop album?
Yeah, Straight Drop Records. It was self-entitled, Gucci Man LaFleur.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So from that album, but it wasn't like how the Trap House album. The Trap House album was worldwide. The Straight Drop album was more hood known. You know what I'm saying? Like, it didn't make it to the big markets, but it was a fire album. So with that Trap House album, my sister gave it to me. So I'm like, oh, bro, done went and tried it, and it happened. So on my way home, my whole town, like, oh, I'm finna try it too. I'm finna try to rap, because I know I can rap. But if bro made it and we from the same cloth, let me see if it'll work for me. You know what I'm saying?
So was you always, because just to pick up a mic and say, let me try it, did this come natural for you? Did it take you some time?
Nah, I want to say it came natural because I didn't even know what name to roll with. My first rap name back then was Goldmouth. And so I was running with Goldmouth for a while. And then I'm like, nah, I need to run with OJ. And I ran with OJ, but then I just added the Juice Man because of the fact some from my area, people call me Juice or OJ. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So I just ran, I put it together, OJ the Juice Man. You know what I'm saying?
Okay, so you go back. You said your original name was Goldmouth.
Goldmouth, yes. This was
those gold teeth in your mouth are permanent, right?
Yeah, they are permanent gold teeth. And I started out with six. I want to say no. When I first went gold teeth, I only had money to buy one. I put an O first, then I got money to buy two. Well, another one. So I had OJ first. Boom. I want to say I was 15 when I did that. I had to get a parent to come sign the paperwork for me to get gold teeth because I went in there thinking they'll just do it. But they saying I was too young, I need the parents. So I called a dude that I knew that was older and had him act like he was my brother. You know what I'm saying? Like, I lived with him. And then I got the OJ first. I probably wore that for 4 years, 5 years, took them out and went, I went, what did I do after I took the two out? I took the two out and went four top, two at the bottom. Took them out, went four at the top, went four at the bottom.
So what made you decide to get them? It's just a fashion statement. You just love gold?
Yeah, it was just something bold and crazy. If back then when we was doing gold teeth, if you was from the streets, you had to have gold teeth. Like, if you didn't have gold teeth, you weren't solidified.
Yeah, so but everybody didn't have permanent gold teeth.
Huh?
Everybody didn't have permanent gold teeth. Like, you
From where we from, like, a lot of people went to Eddie. We knew not to go to Eddie Gold because the thing about Eddie Gold, they was round. You had to go to somebody like Jeffrey, Crook, Broad Street Dental to get the boxed out golds. Like, they were boxed out instead of that round bottom like that. Yeah, so we've been doing gold teeth, man. I want to say it had to been 96, 98 with my first gold, probably even before then. With the OJ I had, was, I was 14, 15 getting gold. I went to three different dentists to get the gold. I seen gold go from 1/5 of tooth to 2/5 of tooth.
Mm-hmm. So, wow. And how many you got now?
Eight, four at the top and four at the bottom.
Okay, you serious about yours.
Nah, my mom was like, bro, everybody trying to get them out. You don't got too old. You need to go white teeth. I said, maybe. I said, baby, you ain't lying.
Yeah, I always wonder where you got that name from, too, OJ Da Juiceman. So it was no play on OJ Simpson, none of that.
Yeah, no. OJ Simpson was never involved. My real name is Otis Williams Jr. So the OJ come from Otis Jr.
Got you.
And instead of some people saying OJ, they be like, hey, Juice. And so I always ran. I've been called Juice OJ since Mount Park, when people really start interacting, having friends.
Got you. Okay, let's take it back to rap for a second.
Okay.
You know, in the 04, them franchise boys, they drop a huge record, mm-hmm. White T. Then you and Gucci, you're part of a group, Never Again Family. Yep, is that
Never
correct?
Again Family from Gresham Road. Yes, correct. That's my buddy Tylo, who had straight drop records. Woke, we call him Woke.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. They switched the label name from Straight Drop Records to Never Again Records.
And y'all drop a record,
Black Tea. Yep, we did.
Was that in direct response? Is that any way a diss? Is it in direct response to the White Tea joint, or you just playing?
No, see, on the east side, what it was, on the east side where we from, we really didn't wear the White Tea because White Tea didn't go with, like, we were a lot of black. So out the gate, we was Black Tea. You can call it Asher Tea Boys. Might have tea five, six days straight. So you already know what the color finna look like on it. So, like, we always have wore Black Tea. Even if they were Asher, we just been the Black Tea gang.
Hmm. Yeah, and that's your first real intro into the rap
scene. To the rap music, yep. Correct.
Yeah, and you come out, and you right there with Gucci at this point. But at this point, I don't know. He didn't drop the Trap House joint at that point, did he? Because it's still early in his career.
Yeah, nah, the Trap House album came when...
That came out, I want to think, around 2005 or something.
Yeah, when he got with... when Gucci got with Big Cat. Mm-hmm.
Got you. And you know, you said by the time that you came back home after doing the boot camp, you know, Gucci had dropped the Trap House.
Mm-hmm, correct.
At this time, the world is taking notice. What was you arrested for? What was you convicted of?
on some street stuff, man. Them charges back then was possession of a firearm. What was it? Possession of a firearm and doing the commission of a crime. Possession of drugs. And attempt to a fleeing attempt.
Got you. Okay, so a lot your career start building. You come home, you get into this rap thing full time.
Mm-hmm.
At that point, Black T, and I want to say it was on the Trap House album.
Oh, they did. They put the remix of the Black T.
It's the remix,
mm-hmm, the one with Lil Scrappy on it.
Lil Scrappy and Jeezy was on it.
Oh, yep. And Jeezy, yep, you right.
Now, was that your first time working with Jeezy?
No, I never really met Jeezy in person. And then around that time, I wasn't around Gucci like that around that time. I was still okay. Probably coming out or in the mix of on the way out.
Okay. You could, because I'm looking at this, and this is where Gucci's career start going crazy.
Okay,
yeah. And this childhood friend of yours, he's starting to blow for real, for real.
For real, for real.
You know, him and Jeezy on that same album, they make their first hit record.
The So Icy
joint.
Mm-hmm.
Are you home at that time?
Was I home? I don't think so.
Okay, but by the time you came home, I'm thinking that that song was, right, it is exploded.
Yeah, exploded. That was his hit song from that album, correct.
And it's crazy because Jeezy and Gucci, at one point, they friends, and just the way I say that your story is so synonymous with Gucci, so is Jeezy's in a way.
True.
You know, them two was cool at this. Do you know what started their beef? Come from what I'm understanding, their disagreement started from that song.
I wasn't present when that was going on, but from what that time that what was going on, yeah, they was probably in disagreement about the actual song. Maybe the paperwork wasn't correct or did correctly before the song exploded the way it did.
Yeah, I know Vlad did a interview with Zaytoven, and Zaytoven was essentially saying that you know, Jeezy wanted it on his album, Gucci wanted it on his album, and that's kind of the way.
See, Zay wouldn't know because Zay was right there in the middle of it. Like, Zay was probably there when they recorded the song. Like,
Jeezy approached you for ownership of the song, and at the time, he was the bigger artist.
Of course.
He was on Def Jam. You know, he had the Boys in the Hood deal. Puffy was behind him. And you know, the streets were on fire with, you know, the Trap or Die mixtape and so forth. But you actually said, nah, I'm gonna stick with Gucci on the song, who's the actual owner of it.
Well, you got to think, Gucci, this is my guy. This is a guy that come to my house 7:30 in the morning every day. Like, we working on music with each other every day. We going to the club every day. We go to the club with our clothes, you know, from the flea market sprayed up with the name of the song that we performing, you know, that night. So there's nobody can come in and say, you know, have me portray Gucci to just because they got a bigger name or who they are. To be honest with you, I was a fan of Gucci more than I was a fan of anybody else. So, you know, I was going to rock with him regardless.
How did that affect you? Or did it affect you in any way?
I don't think it really affected me.
So you didn't feel like you was in the middle of any of this stuff?
Not really, no. I wasn't implicated in the middle of none of that, no.
Got you. I know also, you know, in 05 is a big year, not just for you, but for Gucci. That whole Atlanta scene was going crazy.
At the time, correct.
Around that time. Obviously, we all know Gucci and Jeezy, they fall out. And unfortunately, Gucci winds up catching a case behind fatally shooting one of Jeezy's boys when they supposedly broke into his home.
Okay.
You know, everybody knows this story at this point. But as far as you're concerned, during that period, did that help? Did that help just to put the whole Atlanta scene under a microscope and the music coming out of that scene on a broader level in some way?
Maybe, yes.
Yeah, I mean, you would think because all eyes news. Was on Atlanta.
It was big. It was big in Atlanta around that time. Yeah, correct.
Yeah, I mean, eventually the charges were dropped.
True.
You know, and Gucci was able to, you know, avoid
jail time,
being locked up behind it, which is, you know, unfortunate. Says somebody lost their life in that incident, but you know, it really put a huge spotlight again on that scene that was going on down there, because it was so much great music coming out at the time, and you was right there about to blow yourself. Was you affiliated with Gucci when he had any of the beef with Jeezy or BMF at that point?
Yes, we was yeah.
Okay,
I was around at that time. It was certain stuff he would, you know, put me in on that I was blind of and had to know how to, you know, maneuver right, because we didn't know. See, the thing is with streets, when it's pressure like that and you don't know every face that the pressure coming from, you got to just be careful.
Mm-hmm. You made a statement some time ago. You said, I worked. Niggas might have thought Gucci bought me in the game, but nah, I came in my own. We was just homeboys and Shorty Blue.
Mm-hmm.
You know, for you, I know you was pretty much saying, look, I earned this on my own.
True.
By right.
True.
That didn't in any way be offensive to Gucci, no?
It's hard to say, because, I mean, a lot of people looked at it as I was signed to Gucci. No, I wasn't signed to Gucci. I was always independent. Gucci always been big, bro. So he the type of person like, Juice, you your own man, you hard, you solid, do it on your own. You know what I'm saying? So as far as probably me making that comment, it just went back to speculations of people always thought I was signed to So Ice.
Got you. I mean, you had, you know, some of your early hit records was right there, I mean, with Gucci, which is dope.
True.
You know, correct. Half a Brick.
Mm-hmm.
Do It. Vic, how often was y'all in? Go ahead.
Hmm?
Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Nah, I was saying Vic, Pad, Bye. We don't did a lot of music together for sure back then.
How often was y'all in the studio together?
Well, we was in there a lot back then. Yeah, we was in there a lot. 7 days out of the week, we probably was in there 5.
That's dope. Yeah, I mean, you having access in being affiliated with one of the hottest dudes in the game.
Yeah.
And, you know, and Gucci, obviously, he kept it thorough. Once he blew, you know, he didn't switch up. He was right there with you.
True.
You know, correct. Making them songs.
Correct.
You know, and this off the beaten path for a second.
Okay.
But you was originally diagnosed with type 2 diabetes around that time.
Yep, I got diagnosed in 2008 with type 2, and then it switched to type 1 probably 2009.
Is it true that at one point you went to the hospital and they actually didn't let you stay there because you didn't have insurance and the bill came up to around
$30,000? Which incident? I know I paid... the shooting, when I got shot in 08, that was 20,000. And then the diabetes, getting diagnosed with diabetes, I paid 30,000 for a hospital bill, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
One was 20, one was 30.
Damn. You talked about getting shot. Mm-hmm. How many times was you shot?
I got hit 8 times.
You literally got hit 8 times.
Mm-hmm.
Where at?
Down low. Bullet went all on. My Jordan went through my leg. One hit my scrotum. Went in one side of my scrotum and not the other.
So, getting shot 8 times, unless somebody got some real bad aim, this is meant for OJ. This is somebody
it was
came
a,
looking
it was
for you.
It was a robbery gone bad.
Is a robbery gone bad?
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what happened leading up to that?
Nah.
Just going into the story?
It was like some third party type shit. Like, I knew Sean, but Sean know Vlad, but Vlad know the cameraman here. and the cameraman wanted to get some, wanted to be on some, you know, on Whoop the Whoop. So in the midst of the third party, the cameraman ended up shooting.
Damn. So at that time, you officially OJ the Juice Man rapper.
Nah, not yet. The shooting and the diabetes came right before I blowed up.
Okay. So you came into this game with a 50 Cent story. He got shot 9 times, you got shot 8 times.
Mm-hmm, correct.
Damn. Was you in the hospital? Like, how long was you in the hospital for that?
Man, I got shot on a Sunday. Shit, they put me out the hospital that Wednesday.
Are you serious?
Yeah, I was at home on crutches Wednesday.
Is it true that during that same week that you released from the hospital, you performed?
Yep, I did a show that Friday.
Okay, you got to talk to me. Like, you know, I know I heard an interview of yours before, and you, in one of your claim to fame is, I never missed a paid date before in my life.
One time, that happened, because I can't even keep that no more. I did have one time where I was going to do a show in Oxford, North Carolina, I was going to Jackson, Tennessee. My show that next day was in Oxford, but I ended up getting locked up on the way to Tennessee by Tennessee Highway Patrol. Mm. And missed the Oxford show. I missed the Jackson and the Oxford show. So I don't miss 2 shows off of getting locked up on the way to 1 show.
So you got shot 8 times and made that show.
Yeah.
Was that show at least local? Where was that
show? No, that show was in my first show when I got shot coming back. Oh, it was in Cincinnati, Ohio.
Damn. So you get shot, you get out on a Wednesday, mm-hmm. You on a plane.
No, we drove Friday to Cincinnati.
Was you on stage with crutches?
Yeah,
I couldn't move. Obviously, you bandaged up.
Yeah, I'm on stage with the crutches. I couldn't move because they hit the nerves on my right leg. So my right leg, I couldn't really move at the time. And I'm just standing on stage with crutches. I couldn't interact how I usually interact when I'm performing. But they seen that the reason why I couldn't interact, I was fucking standing on crutches.
How did even the healing process go? Because I know you just got diagnosed before that with the diabetes.
Mm-hmm.
What was the healing process?
I was scared on that because I remember I got diagnosed with diabetes first, and then I got shot. But in the midst of diagnosed with diabetes, I did a diabetes class down there at Grady. And one of the main things they were saying was you weren't going to heal the same. So in my mind, I'm like, oh, man, I would get shot. After these folk telling me I ain't gonna heal right because I got diabetes, but it ended up, I healed pretty good because, like, I remember at a show, one of the bullets that was still lodged in my leg fell out at a show one day while I'm performing. I feel something fall down my leg. Look, it's one of the bullets. It popped out on its own.
Yo, you gotta be kidding me.
Bullshit, you're not.
Yeah. You felt the bullet while you was on stage.
While I'm on stage rapping, I feel something fall down my pant leg.
Okay, do you at least stop the show? Do you stop the song and say?
I want to say I kept going, but I picked up the bullet because I wanted to keep it.
Do you still have it to this day?
Yep, I got it sitting at home in a little plastic wrap.
Are there any other bullets still in you?
Nah, it was just one still lodged in me, but they saying it wasn't no need to do surgery to take it out because it wasn't life threatening. It'll work its own self out.
Okay. Is there any long term damage that you can see? Do you know, is there a limp? Is there any?
Oh yeah, it's a limp. I got a mild limp because of that right leg when the bullets pinched the nerve. So sometimes it feel like I'm walking on needles and I can't like do my toes on my right, how I can do my left. Like my left is freely, but my right barely moves. Like, you know, so I can't just do my toes like that, like how my left one is, then my right.
What about with the, when it rained? Do you feel pain like most people would say, you know?
Yeah, no, not really. One of my closest friend who got killed, R.P. Block Beater, he was in a wheelchair from previous getting shot in the back at a payphone. And that was one of his main pet peeves, that when it rained, his lower level will be hurting, like it'll cramp up.
So you don't get those same pains at all?
Nah, not when it rained.
Thank God. The people who shot you, though, the person, matter of fact, was it one person or was it multiple people?
As me thinking, looking back in the vehicle, the shooters, no, it was just two. It was two dudes.
It was two people shooting at you at the same time?
No, it was one person shooting, but they was in the car too deep.
Okay. Did anybody ever get arrested for that?
Nah, not that I know of.
And was you the only person hit?
Yes, me and the vehicle I was in was hit bad.
Okay, let's fast forward then. You know, thank God everything worked out. I mean, getting shot 8 times is, you know, that's a lot.
A lot of people don't live. Yeah, a lot of people live.
People get shot one time.
One shot. Yeah.
Yeah, they get shot one time and they ain't
die.
So I hope, you know, you thank God and continue to thank God.
True.
09, you know, your buzz is out of here. True. Everybody talking that OJ the Juice Man talking.
Nah, for real. For real.
You one of the biggest things out there. You signed a Asylum Records.
Mm-hmm.
How big was that deal?
And
was it a big record deal?
I'm blind on that because I was signed to Mosaic Entertainment, which they got the distribution through Asylum. So I'm blind on the actual contract.
But I'm assuming that you took home a nice...
No, I took home no license, nothing.
No advance?
$10,000.
Okay. As hot as you was? All right, we'll talk about it. what's the name of your first album? What's the name of that debut album? Other Side of the Trap?
The Other Side of the Trap.
Yep, why you correct. Name it that?
And back then I just wanted to show them it's a whole nother side than just trapping because of the fact I made it into the music game.
You know, off of that album, I know you had some new joints and you also put some joints that was previously released on the mixtapes.
Mixtapes, yeah.
Yeah, but your biggest song to date, if I'm not wrong, was make the track say A.
Correct.
And that's featuring Gucci.
Correct.
Now, you know, where the inspiration for that song come from?
Sitting in Zay basement. It was a record day for us, me and Gucci. He had a set time. I had a set time of what when we were supposed to be recording. Zay playing beats for Gucci. And Gucci passed on to make the track say A beat. So I kind of tap Zay, like, you know, put that to the side for me for my time when it's me, my time to record or whatnot. So in the process of that, I had already wrote the hook, wrote one of the verses. When it was my time to record, Gucci ended up liking what I put on it. And he put his verse on it. I put a third verse on it. That was back when we was rapping 16 bars, 3 verses. And that's how they came about, sending Zay basement, going through beats, and home passed on that beat. I end up grabbing it and then make the trap say A came about.
Okay, so I talked to artists who made records, made monster records, and they knew from the gate when they heard the beat, when they learned, laid their verse, put the hook down, this is going to be a smash. And I talked to artists who their biggest records, they didn't even like. They didn't think was going to be a hit. When y'all was recording that joint, did you know this was going to be your biggest record?
No, not at the time, because once I put that record out and start maneuvering that record, a lot of feedback come back saying it's not radio material because you talking too much about drugs or whatnot. So it took, I worked Make the Trap Say A like 2 years, 2.5 years before it blew up. I worked it like streetwise.
Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
So was you pushing that kind of on your own because you knew that record was going to be a monster? Even though
I knew that record had momentum. That's why if you look back or date back, I put that record on at least 4 mixtapes back to back. Like, because I knew that record had momentum and just people didn't see it because of what was illustrated in that song.
Gotcha. That's why you can't give up when your gut is telling you something's right, and when the, mm-hmm. more important, when the people are telling you,
true,
this is a hit. Like this is your hit right here. You can't listen to everybody around you, because some of the biggest records ever, they didn't start off as radio smash.
Nah, I'm telling you, they would hear me with, boy, that never see radio, that never make radio, boy. It's a good song, but it ain't gonna make radio.
Yeah, but I'm a firm believer that it's always about the people. It's always about your fan base.
True.
The people dictate.
And see, back then when I was working that record, here in Atlanta, some radio stations got Dig It or Dish It. Especially back then. I put it on there. And I had my whole family, everybody I knew, call in and, hey, we like that record, did that record, you know what I'm saying? So that kind of helped the record grow legs too. Like, I'm telling you, I had my mama, my sister, I had everybody in they, you can think of, call in and say, that record.
Nah, that's dope. And I remember them days too.
Yeah.
That album also had I'm Getting Money on it.
Oh, yeah. And see, I'm Getting Money was my supposedly first hit single. But when people got a whiff of Make the Trap Say, hey, it blow I'm Getting Money out the water. Like, and I'm Getting Money was, I'm on the solo, no features. It was a bigger record when I dropped that first. But once people got a whiff of Make the Trap Say, hey, it was over with for I'm Getting Money. Even though that was my first hit single.
That was technically your first hit single.
Yes, correct.
Yeah, because up north, everybody started to look at you based on that record.
On that record right there, correct.
Yeah, and then came...
Make the Trap Say A.
There you go, exactly. Mm-hmm. Right behind it.
But and, I also had The Copper Chicken was a good record that was on there. The I Be Trapping was kind of sort of like a Copper Chicken, but Copper Chicken was bigger than I Be Trapping, so I can't even really say... I Be Trapping, but Copper Chicken, I'm Getting Money, Make the Trap Say A.
You know, it, as big as these records are, you really are well known for your ad libs.
Yes, correct.
You know, is this intentional on your part? Is this something that you was doing and just was like, yo, you know what? People really picking up on these ad libs. Like, where did the whole ad lib thing come from for you?
Sitting in the studio trying to find something to add to the music, because back then I wasn't doing the A's. I was just doing like, okay. Oh, you know what I'm saying? I wasn't doing the A, okay. I wasn't doing the A's yet. So I started off with the okay, but I'm sitting in the studio, you know, how you re-listen to the music after it's been recorded or whatnot. I'm like, bro, it needs something else to it, because like it got the bounce to it, but it's like it's missing something. So I'm, you know, sitting around in the studio playing around with different words of trying to do a ad lib besides just saying, okay. And then the high-pitched A's came about, but I used to, instead of doing them frequently, I used to just long stretch them like, hey, hey, and then I went to, hey, 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 you know what I'm saying? I went like that. So that kind of, yeah.
Yeah, because, you know, a lot of people recognize you for some of the dopest ad-libs in the game.
Man, that's real, and I appreciate them for that. Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. I remember hearing you say, and I think, and you correct me if I'm wrong, you like Soulja Boy stole some of them ad-libs. Was that just you having a moment, or do you?
Nah, he actually did, but, you know, we made amends to it.
So he actually did?
Yeah, he actually
But y'all are good now?
Yeah, we had made music. It took some time for us to, you know, kind of bond together because I was mad off the fact, like, bro, I'm a street nigga. Like, don't steal from me, bro. Like, bro, if you only knew what it took for me to even create that stuff for you to then come saying it, like, you made it. Nah, don't do that. And it was just a big misunderstanding, which led to good things because me and Soulja recorded 2-3 songs after that. And he brought me to keep it 100. Soulja Boy was the reason why I made it to the stage of the BET Hip Hop Awards. Or what was that? 20? What year was that? 2010 BET Hip Hop Awards, something like that. But if you seen me on stage of a BET Hip Hop Awards, it was because of Soulja Boy. He wanted me to come out and do the A's for the Gucci Bandana. Because, you know, he stole it and put it into the implicated into that song.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and then I wasn't on that song, you know what I'm saying? So, and then he brought me to BET Hip Hop. Well, I was already coming to the awards. My reason for getting on stage was for Soulja Boy.
That's dope. That's dope. Shout out to Soulja.
Yeah, big shout out to Soulja. Big Draco, what they call him.
You know, Kanye West recently said that Soulja is like one of the top five most important artists. Would you agree with that?
Who said it?
Kanye West.
Mm. Top five?
Top five.
That's Kanye's opinion. I don't know.
I mean, you know, if it's his opinion, then everybody's entitled to their opinion. True. So,
like the asshole, everybody with that. Got one.
You know, you got a dope joint that I love too. Me being from the East Coast,
okay,
with my man Jada Kiss, the Who's Real man, that joint. That joint was is fire. How'd that come together?
Jada Kiss reached out probably to Mazay Entertainment or something at the time. I got a call saying Jada Kiss want to do a song. I'm like, shit, fuck yeah. All the albums, I don't bought a Jada Kiss, you know what I'm saying? I like Jada Kiss and Style P. I bought both of their shit so many times. When I got the phone call, I didn't record with Jada Kiss personally, but they double backed to shoot the video in New York, Yonkers.
Yeah, no, that joint was crazy.
Yeah, that was a big
Was y'all in the studio together when you recorded?
No, I didn't record it with Jada Kiss. It was emailed to me. I did what I supposed to do and signed it back.
Okay, you also got another joint with R. Kelly, Superman High.
Superman High, yep. That was another record. Well, phone call came in. They say R. Kelly want to do a record with you. I'm like, word? Not Kelly? Not the big dog? Tell him come on with it. But then it ended up we couldn't be in the studio together at the time when they signed it. So I recorded the hook. I wrote the hook and my verse. I recorded the hook, put my verse on it. And the studio I was at had connections with R. Kelly. So they signed it back and Kelly ended up liking it and used it.
Okay, so I know you wasn't in the studio with him when y'all recorded it. Did you ever get to meet him afterwards?
No, we posted it. I got another call saying he was doing, was it Jimmy Fallon? It was something, one of them late night shows that's kind of big. I got a call saying he wanted to use the record to go do it on there. Would I mind coming? I'm like, yeah. You know, I ain't tripping. R. Kelly, it's main screen, it's big screen. You know what I'm saying? Tell him come on with it. You know what I'm saying? But then at the end, something happened the way it collapsed and it didn't go through. But he ended up still doing the show. It's just the fact that I wasn't able to be in on it where it collapsed. I don't know what happened.
So especially now, I mean, R. Kelly, at the time that you made that song, is a very different R. Kelly than today, as we all know.
Not correct.
He's been convicted, I want to think, on all counts. Dang. Has your feelings changed toward him as an artist? Not necessarily the person, but as an artist?
Nah, because I looked at it as home didn't have to extend a hand to come fuck with me. So by him extending a hand to come get the Superman high record, I can't really tell you the ins and outs of what's going on with his case. I put that to the side. That's R. Kelly, even though I never met him personally, like we never shook hands. I just appreciate the fact that he let me do what I do on a record with him. But by me doing trap rap and this fucking R. Kelly, and you on a record with OJ Da Juiceman, come on with it.
Yeah, I mean, that was a call a lot of artists would have been happy to get.
Yeah, nah, for real.
Especially, you know, when Kells was at his all-time high.
Yes, correct. Same way with Jada. I got that phone call from him. It wasn't no hesitation. Come on with it, Jada.
Yeah, y'all did y'all thing too on it. I want to double back because, you know, earlier you kind of alluded to this when we was talking, and I told you we would you know, chop it up about it. But you made a statement. You said you didn't get a dime off your debut album.
Go ahead.
That can't, outside of your advance. You said you know every artist get an advance.
Mm-hmm.
You got 10 racks.
Yeah, just 10.
Is that the last payment that you ever seen?
No, I got another 10 for supposedly working on my second album, but that collapsed too. So with that being said, like, I made money off Make the Trap Say A, yes, by doing shows before I separated from them. 50% of my show money was getting took too.
50%?
50.
Okay. I know, and I'm only asking this because I worked at a record label for many years.
Okay.
So I understand how much, let's just even say you were signed to a 360 deal.
Mm-hmm.
I understand how much you're supposed to get taken from you from the label. I also understand if you were being managed. Now, were you being managed by the same people you were signed to?
Correct.
But it still wouldn't add up to 50. You sure you got those numbers right? 50%? It still wouldn't add up to 50%.
Yeah. I was getting 15 grand a show back then. I was only picking up the back end 75. I never seen the front end money on none of the shows when I was with them people. I got finagled into the front end of the show money juice is going back into the company. But then I had to illustrate it. I don't own the company, so why am I putting 50% into a company I don't own?
And what was the answer?
When no answer.
Okay, this is a question that I have for all artists. Just to be fair to the record label side, to be fair to the management side, because many artists always say I got jerked by, you know, the people I was signed to.
Mm-hmm.
Where was your lawyer? Did you sign a contract? I mean, it's standard to have a lawyer.
I signed without a lawyer.
How is that even possible that you can sign a contract without a lawyer?
The thing was, I told them folk that if I make it out the hospital from being shot 8 times, I'm coming to sign. And you know what I'm saying? I looked at that one person from that label as like a mama figure. So a lot of stuff we did off of handshake type, nod your head, yeah, type shit. So me, damn near dying from diabetes because my blood sugar was like a fucking 800-900 something. I get diagnosed with diabetes 1 week. 7 days later, I get shot 8 times. So in the process of that, the person who I was signed to come in, see me in the hospital, fucked up, then the like down bad off the diabetes 1 week. They in my ear, hey Juice, what are you doing? You on, you know, these folks want to sign, I can get you to these white people in New York. I can do this, I can do that. But me, I'm still street mode wise. I didn't really have a whole bunch of belief in I can make it with the rap. So I'm like, yeah, I hear you, whoop the whoop, but I got this street shit going on that's bringing way more money. Whoop the whoop. So I get shot a week later, 7 days, 6 days later. They back in the hospital like, yo, dude, what are you doing? You on your deathbed, bro. You don't got diabetes. You don't got shot. Let me get you to the white folk. Let me get you out the street. All right. Boom. You like a mama figure, whoop the whoop to me. You know what? When I get out the hospital, I'm coming straight to the office to sign. Had the paperwork ready. Boom. I pull up. Here go the paperwork. I ain't got no lawyer, nobody on my behalf. But I know what I told you. So I kept my word. I came inside. No lawyer, no nothing involved. You might have had your people on the side. The people who I signed to might have had their people on the sideline. I had no one. I just went up there and I don't even want to, and this is what I told you, folks. I don't even want to read the contract. Show me why I signed it.
Damn. Okay, so I got to, at some point, you got to take some of this blame. I'm assuming you being
I know I fucked up. Yeah, and I admit of me fucking up. I didn't really, and see, you got to look at it. I'm coming from the street, so I don't know nothing about music, but I know how to rap. And that's what I ran with. I fucked up. Yeah, I did.
Yeah, you got to own that. Because if what you saying is 100%, you got to own a part of that that's,
I did.
You did. As a man, I'm sitting here and I'm listening.
I fucked up. Yeah. There's no ifs, and buts about that. Yeah, I went up there and I jumped off the porch, if you call it. Jumped in the water with the sharks.
Okay, let me ask you. Did you ever confront these people and say, you know, I messed up?
No, I waited. I let it get badder. And once I started finding out what was missing, I stepped away like, you know what? I'm cool. So what I did after that was, it's two contracts. One signed to get with you and one signed to get away from you.
So you never actually said, I signed this contract in good faith. Y'all know I was loyal. I just went through the worst period of my life. You know, I had diabetes. I got shot. And y'all was there for me when I needed it. So I'm asking you to be here for me when I need it. Again, this contract is unfair. Let us renegotiate. You never had that conversation.
My negotiation will let me out the contract. Okay, if you want to get out, you got to sign this right here. And this right here basically states, you sign this, you cannot come back and sue us for anything dealing with the other side of the trap for your life and 10 years after your life.
For your natural life?
Yeah, for my life and 10 years after my life.
So if you left this earth, your kids can't even sue for 10 years after you're gone.
Correct.
That was in writing or told to you?
No, that was in writing, in the contract. That's to get away from you contract. It's two contracts. One to get what you want to get away from you.
Okay. The second contract, did you have a lawyer?
Yes.
And so now your lawyer has a chance to read through. And your lawyer is telling you, you can't do anything about back royalties, anything.
Yeah, I told the lawyer, I'm gonna keep it 1,000. I told the lawyer, tell her, come on with what she coming on with. I let her have the other side of the trap. Just let me away. But I, me not knowing back then, the other side of the trap was gonna have my biggest records that made a lot of money. I didn't know that. Nobody really schooled me on it. I just know, I felt like in my heart, hey, bro, you fucked up signing them bad paperwork. Just get away from them and try it again. But not knowing it, it wasn't going to be that same momentum when I first started.
Yeah, I mean, it's and this is for any artist. This is for any businessman. It's hard to catch lightning in a bottle twice.
Real talk.
You know, it may be from their standpoint, they made you. They put all of their resources and money into making. You had the talent, obviously, but you needed their vehicle. You needed their financial backing.
True.
You know. Wow. Sorry to hear that, brother. Damn. So where does that situation stand now?
Oh, shit. I mean, I'm independent. I'm away from them. I can't tell you I own the rights to make the trap say, hey.
You do not. Wow. Okay, so you get into, you know, and I'm just fast forwarding a little bit, and maybe this is around the same time. There's a show in Broward County.
Florida.
In Florida.
Mm-hmm.
Did you get shot then, or was you almost shot again?
No, I was shot at.
And okay, last time you said it was kind of a third party robbery go wrong.
Mm-hmm.
This time, was they gunning for OJ?
I just know when it was my time to walk to the stage to perform, niggas started hitting. Like, oh yeah, pop, 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 pop. You know what I'm saying? But it stemmed back from when I was in the VIP, when I first arrived at the club, they had a VIP session for me. Okay, cool, boom. We're in the VIP. About 3-4 dudes walk up towards the VIP. Like, the club part is like on this half of the club. The VIP is kind of like on the separate half of the club. So it wasn't really no need for them to be on my side. But you know me, I ain't no funny acting dude. Like, boy, you know what I'm saying? So I let them approach. And when they approach, I don't understand some of that Geechee language. You know what I'm saying? It sound like, I don't know. I don't understand. So in the midst of that, it went from good to bad because when they approached, I guess since they from, you know how it be when you from that city, nigga like, oh, bro, I run this my club, this my hood, whoop, whoop, club in my hood, nigga, I run this shit. So in the midst of that, I had on a pink shirt, pink socks. So I don't know if they thought I was pussy or what, you know what I'm saying? Because I got on pink. So they count, but it kind of go hostile immediately. I guess they weren't getting the proper recognition that they wanted from me. So it went left field. They went to, damn near talking Creole or voodoo type shit. I don't know what the fuck them nigga was saying. So goddamn, in the midst of that, I'm coming up out my shirt and I'm like, come on. Like, bro, let's do it. Since y'all taking it there, and it didn't have to go there, but if y'all think I'm pussy, let me show y'all. So, boom, that popping off. And in the meantime, club security see from a standpoint, I'm taking my shirt off. They come, see what's going on. They see we into it with these 3-4 dudes. So security say they finna put them out. I don't care what security do with them, just get them away from me because they finna go left field. So I'm guessing they made them go to the front of the club or whatnot, boom. So promoter come to me like, yo, Juice, I know it just kind of went bad over here. Do you still want to perform? I'm like, yeah. Why am I not perform? I'm way from Georgia. I'm finna perform. I don't care about what they started or what they was talking about. These folk paid to see me. I'm finna give it to them. So boom. In the midst of walking toward the stage, like coming from the VIP, you got to go across the stage, make the left, then go up on the stage. in the midst of me coming in front of the stage to go toward the step, you just hear pop, 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 pop. I'm like, oh shit, these niggas bust. So I'm like, I ain't got my fire with me. You know what I'm saying? I'm really, really solely relying on security to come and convict the felon. You feel me? Me and him, we get to tussling over the fire. I feel like he ain't just doing what he's supposed, what you paid for. You know what I'm saying?
You so and the security.
Give me your fire. And I'm a security. You know what I'm saying? So in the midst of me and security, my security, going back and forth over the gun, he got the ass end of the gun. I got majority of the front of the gun. So we like this, tug of war, motherfucker. Give me the fire. So in the midst of that, a dude jump out the closet. Like it's a storage space closet right here in the midst of going toward the stage. He jumped and grabbed this part of the gun. Soon as he busts out the closet, I'm like, oh shit. So now in my eyes, I don't have majority of the fire. You know what I'm saying? So I can only think of what's best for me. Don't let bro get their fire, cause we don't know who he with. My thing was to poke his eyes out, cause you can't grab no gun if you can't see. You know what I'm saying? So I poke his eyes out. I let loose of the part of the scrap I had. I poke his eyes out like, hey, whoop de whoop. But come to find out, he was in fear of his life because he hadn't shoot. That's why he was hid in the closet. So when he jumped out, he thinking it's us who shoot. No, we trying to defend ourselves, buddy. These folk hitting at me, walking to the stage. I just want to go and rap. Yeah, I had a problem with some dudes trying to I guess they wanted to debo my VIP or just take the I don't know what they really wanted. You know what I'm saying? About the VIP. But they said I didn't really comply to what they were saying, which in actuality, I couldn't even fucking understand. I don't know that language, you know what I'm saying? So that happened. We get outside. The promoter gone. Promoter gone. We get outside. 12 talking about, hey, because my security still got hit fire in his hand. Police talking about get on the ground. They laid my security down. I didn't have no fire, so they couldn't lay me down. But by him walking out the door with the gun in his hand, they laid him down because they police implications of they don't know who the shooter is. They know they got a call saying gunshots inside the club. Yeah, but I feel like they were targeted at me, like, because why would shooting be going on if the security didn't put these niggas out? These niggas tried to debo my shit, but the promoter, I guess, the promoter might have known them. I don't know. The promoter didn't make them leave. So it went bad. You know what I'm saying? Went left field. Dude, them really went to shoot. Now, did any bullets hit me? No. I just was worried about where the shots was coming from, who was the shooter, and was it aimed at me? And it went from there, from me trying to secure me with my security pistol, because I felt like, in my eyes, he wasn't. I wanted him to shoot back. What he gonna shoot at, I don't know. But then, as I think about it, it might have been bad if he shot back. You know what I'm saying? Because we really didn't see exactly where the shooting was coming from. We walking toward the stage to go rap. You hear pop, pop, pop. You already know what's gonna happen in the club if you hear pop, pop, pop. Niggas running, ducking, club in chaos right now. So I'm not looking to try to, oh boy, it's them right there. I'm trying to secure me with his gun. I know if I got a gun in my hand, I got better chances of living if somebody shoot at me and I got a gun, I can hit back at wherever that shooting coming from. But it didn't go like that, you know what I'm saying? So yeah, I don't got shot at him, bro, for sure.
Now, was that your security, somebody who traveled with you, or was that the club security?
That we tussling over the fire?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's my security.
Okay, after that show, did he still work for you?
Yes and no. It maybe took me a while to come back. Because, the fact is, a lot of people who work with me, I've been knowing for years, like, I didn't get them placed to me. You know what I'm saying? I had that happen when I was with the label. And a lot of that went bad because of the fact I couldn't recollect to what they was doing, you know what I'm saying? So when I went independent, I just started hiring a lot of people that I knew that needed money, but also wanted to be there to help me, you know what I'm saying? So yeah, it was one of my personal security that I been knowing for years, but he only did it right in his mind because he already know I'm gonna go left field. But not just necessarily saying I'm gonna just shoot up the crowd, no. But Juice finna try to, I know what Juice gonna do. Juice get the gun in the hand, he finna see where this shit coming from, who firing, he gonna shoot back. So maybe it was a good thing he didn't give me the fire, because who know what kind of charges I would have had of me trying to bust back at some niggas who shooting at me. So what they call it, self-defense. But if it's self-defense and I hit an innocent bystander, it ain't self-defense. So maybe he did do good by not giving me, let me take responsibility of his fight on.
Mm-hmm. I mean, you getting busted a few times. Do you got PTSD? Like when them shots went off
for you? I can only think of cover me. Like, hey, I'm gonna do whatever to make sure OJ the Jew, man, be one of the ones that walking away, not getting carried away.
Mm-hmm. All right, in 2010, you release your second album, The Otis Williams Jr. Story.
Jr. Story. Mm-hmm.
Did that come out independent? Did you put that out yourself?
Or I did put it, come... it out. Yeah, I put it out. I did everything right with that album. Paid the producers, tried to go to proper channels. It just, I guess with no major behind you, it kind of get overlooked.
Okay, so looking back on it, would you have taken this same route? And went independent, or would you have tried to make amends and get it right and kept the momentum going that you had at that time?
It wasn't no make, you saying make amends with the label that I was
yeah.
with?
Mm-hmm.
Nah, it wasn't no, nah, hell nah, I'm cool. If it took that to try to keep going, it just went over with for OJ the Juice, man. I just wouldn't have did no more rapping. Because ain't no way I would have stayed with them folk knowing what they took.
Even renegotiating.
Unless they would have repaid me, yeah. Mm-hmm. I would have stayed. And see, that what my thing was, like, it wasn't really no reason to take all the money because of the fact if everything would have been solidified as being 100, I would still be with them folk because that's the type of person I am. Like, if they wouldn't have did nothing wrong, nothing shady, I wouldn't have found out anything bad, I still probably would have been with them folk making money. But once I realized what was being took, I had to get away, bro. I ain't no way, because, like, I'm from the streets, bro. Like, I done seen shootouts happen over $100. So you mean to tell me you could take millions and nothing happened to you? Nah, bro. That ain't where I come from.
You know, Waka stepped in at one point.
Been doing something he don't have no record of. Yeah, I know that's your mama. No, you don't know my contract. Why is you coming in saying something? You weren't there when I signed. You didn't read the ins and outs of this contract one and contract two. I know that's your mama. Hell yeah, you slick supposed to feel some kind of way, but when you don't have no record of what's going on, man, shut the fuck up. Because you know where I'm about. You know where I come from.
Granted, like you said, that is his mother.
That's your mom.
Okay, anybody, that's cool. Go ahead.
I'm going to go hard for my mom too. But know your shit before you go hard for your mom.
Have you and him ever spoke outside of social media?
Not since the last shit. Like, before that, it was, I need a verse and whoop the whoop. But, hey, you get in your feeling because your mama took some. I don't need to talk to you because you're going to go left.
So, as it stands now, both of y'all just, man, keep your ways.
Bro. I can care less about what you got going or doing. You or your mama.
Got you. You know, you put out a bunch of dope mixtapes.
Mm-hmm.
And what surprised a lot of people is you got into a Twitter feud with Gucci at one point.
Yeah.
Now that's this is your big brother.
He tried to blast me. Yeah, but he was only speaking fact because I recently just went and looked at it like, damn, bro, really? He was on some. I couldn't tell you what he was on, but he in that midst of him being what he was on, he said, damn, that's fucked up deal. Got my boy back at the store trapping again. She knows she took $500,000. He said this in Twitter. At the time, I'm looking at it like, damn, bro, why you fuck you blasting me for saying I'm back at Tesco? You know where I come from. you know Juice Man is Tesco shot. So why, you know what I'm saying? So, but at the same time, I was mad about it when it first happened because I'm like, now you my boy. If anything, you probably gave me game on that music shit. I didn't know. You feel me? But you really blasted it because you knew what she was doing. You say, hey, damn, that fucked up deal got you back at the Tesco knowing she took $500,000. Damn, $500,000? Where that was at? I sure would like to see that. $500,000? Who? $500,000? Oh, man, come on with it. That was mine? Oh, man, come on, man. I ain't know that.
How are y'all two today?
Right now?
Mm-hmm.
We good.
You and Gooch?
He called time. Mm-hmm.
Dope. Yeah, because y'all are deeper than the music.
Way deeper than the music. That's why a lot of the shit, me and home come from goddamn. Can I take your trash out? We come
at
from that.
At what point, what'd you say?
I said, we come from that.
Exactly. Yeah, that's why I was so surprising to everybody that y'all two of all people was going back and forth.
And see, I tried to stay away from that shit. It just fucked me up that he tried to blast me like. And what they saying is now they got, well, if you know, you know. Like, don't whoop me. Let's just keep that shit silent. Whatever you're going through, you know what I'm saying? I'm here for you. You my brother. But don't throw me under the bus because you going through some shit.
At one point, wasn't you like, you know, I'm done with all this music?
Yeah, kind of, sort of, yeah.
Did you ever just fully walk away from the game?
No. And yeah, like far as leaving it, not doing it no more, no. But recording, and just super putting it out how I was back then? No. Yes, I mean.
Okay, so where are you at today? Are you back fully focused?
Yeah, back fully focused, but I feel like I kind of maybe waited too long, maybe. I don't know. It's a lot of shit that I'm lacking as far as trying to be the 2009 OJ the Juice Man.
What you mean?
Like, far as momentum, the right direction, constantly recording, constantly what they're saying, being in these folk faith, because that's what it's about. Like, you cannot have time off if you want to be like a known top rapper or whatnot. Because once you take that time off, it's somebody to slide in your lane that's newer and younger. You know what I'm saying? Like, the generation I come from, the generation now, they might not really listen to OJ the Juice Man because they feel like he an old rapper. Like, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
It ain't the same generation.
So what can we expect from you moving forward?
I'm gonna give it another try. I just recently put out a mixtape, just trying to test the water or whatnot to see if, you know, my fans still generally there. Which they are. I got some genuine fans that really, some hardcore OJ the Juice Man fan. It just, the fact of now, because you know, back when I made it, it wasn't social media. Now in social media, you got to stay in these four faith. You got to. Soon as you let up, you giving room for someone else to slide in that might still be, that might be rapping what you rap. It's just in a newer way. So The fans gravitate towards him than you, even though, yeah, you might have said it first, but the newer way to say it is better.
Well, you know, I wish you the best. You know, I love your music.
Appreciate it. I sure thank you for that.
Yeah, I really do. And in some ways, you know, this is one of them cautionary tale stories, because right at the heart, like at the top, at the peak of your career, you know, you took a back seat and
it fucked me up. I ain't gonna lie. It fucked me up. It knocked me down because I'm not that top tier artist that I was, that people used to look for. You know what I'm saying? Like, I let too much time, like, even with that situation, with the bad contract shit, I let too much time come and then trying to work it out. You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely. Okay, let me ask you this before I let you go. If you could do it all over again, what would you change?
What would I change? I would try to say I probably would need to be more industry related minded of what's supposed to transpire about with contracts. Like back then, I'm coming from the street. Straight up all day, every day, street mode to versus I gotta read the paperwork and try to do everything correct. In the street ain't no paperwork.
Well, I'm even asking, even after you got out of that bad contract, right? Mm-hmm. Would you have flooded the streets with more music? Would you have?
I would say I would have, because if I look at it from now to back then, if I just would have waited a little more time before I signed, I would have been good. All I had to do was just wait, because it was around the corner, but I wasn't seeing. I just wanted to get out the street, so I wasn't seeing that. Hey, if you wait, your rap career really around the corner. But I ain't wait. I feel like what I would change now is me staying independent and weighing it out, because the shit was around the corner.
Yeah, it was right there.
I just didn't know it.
Well, again, man, I'm wishing you the best. You know, dope is dope. And as an artist, you are definitely a dope artist. So
thank you, bro. You know, thank you. God, I get in the mode where I'm like, damn, what folk just don't, I don't know. And I be getting hate comments and whatnot on Insta and Twitter. Is it because of the fact the generation now, they don't understand you having to stand on the corner to pay your phone bill? They don't understand you had to stay on the corner to pay your light bill. You know what I'm saying? They don't know that. So it just, you know, good with the bad.
Well, keep pushing, brother. You know, at the end of the day, good music, you know, I always say cream will rise to the top. True. So as long as you flooding the streets with dope music, whether you took a step back or not, people will discover you. They'll rediscover you. It ain't like,
rediscover,
you know, yeah.
True.
Like, it ain't like you a new artist. It ain't like your name, you know, it don't come with a certain amount of value.
True, correct.
Peace and love, OJ, and thank you,
OJ the Juiceman, man. VladTV, man. Y'all already know what it do, man. Just go shout. Big shout out to Vlad. Big shout out to Sean, man. You already know he rocking like cut out stocking. Let's get it.
My brother, you be good.
Man, thank you, brother. Already.
One love.